Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to the Alamance County Stepping Up Day of Action. As my grandmother used to say, if you don't like the weather in Burlington, just stand still and it will change. This started out to be an outdoor event. We kind of made a last minute decision to move it indoors and couldn't think of a better place than the historic Paramount Theater here in downtown Burlington. It's my pleasure now to welcome Commissioner Bob Burt and Sheriff Terry Johnson, who will bring welcoming remarks to today's Stepping Up Day of Action. Let me say, I would like to welcome Seth and Commissioner Burt, would like to welcome every single one of you here. To many of you, and to me, Commissioner Burt, and those who've been involved in trying to implement this particular program, this is a very special day for Alamance County. But I was in law enforcement and have been for like 47 years now. I will never forget the first call as a deputy sheriff in Pitt County that I went on. It was a guy that had been in and out of Cherry Hospital many times with mental illness. But nobody wanted to help him. That particular call, when I rolled in the driveway, it was a man with a gun. And I could see it like it was yesterday. Shot himself right in the head in front of me. And I've never forgotten that vision. For the 47 years in law enforcement, I have asked myself, why has America, why has North Carolina, why has Alamance County turned their back on our mental health illness? Today, thanks to Commissioner Byrd, who brought the Stepping Up Initiative to our attention, we have an opportunity to make a profound difference in the mental health system, not only in Alamance County, but to be a leader here to go forth to other counties and other states. That we care and we can make a difference. All it takes is all of us to get involved and march to this cause. And today, this is a prime example of what can be done if we want to do it. And I'm telling you folks this, I'm not going to lay down until it is done. And with that in mind, I want to invite our Commissioner Bob Burt.
Welcome everybody. Again, my name is Bob Byrd and I'm the co-chair of the local Stepping Up Initiative along with my fellow co-chair, Susan Osborne. Stand up, Susan, so they can see you. This whole initiative was started across the country as a result of somebody at the national level noticing that the biggest mental health institutions that we have in our country are county jails. The biggest one in the country is the Los Angeles County Jail. The biggest one in North Carolina is the Mecklenburg County Jail. And really the worst place for somebody with mental illness is the jail, the detention center. Probably the second worst is a hospital emergency room, because the services that these folks need aren't going to be provided. So the National Association of Counties, which represents county commissioners across the country, the American Psychiatric Institute Foundation, and the Council of State Governments, the Justice Center, came together to promote counties doing an initiative and really taking action to address this problem. And action can be done, and this is being done, and you're going to hear about it. But this is not just a law enforcement problem or a mental health problem. It's a community-wide problem. And our initiative, like the ones that are successful across the country, involve a lot of segments of our community. So we brought it back, as the sheriff said, when we heard this idea at a conference and got our board of commissioners to pass a resolution saying that we will take action in Alamance County, and action is what's happening. So we have a leadership team of, maybe 14 or 15 people. If anybody is on our Stepping Up Initiative leadership team, please stand up. Several people from NAMI, the National Alliance for Mental Illness, they're here today. Would you please stand up and be recognized? Not everybody stood up. And then we, all the law enforcement officials that we have. If you're law enforcement, would you please stand up? Thank everybody for being here. This is a day of celebration to bring attention, and this is happening across the country, to bring attention to this issue and how important it is. So you're going to be hearing from a lot of important speakers. So first, though, before we get to them, I'm going to turn it over. She's important too. Becky from the Gibsonville Police Department.
Thank you. Hello, thank you.
Hello.
Hello. I'm Becky Dixon. I'm the Assistant Chief for the Gibsonville Police Department. Thank you. Can you hear me?
Yes.
I am the co-chair for the CIT Steering Committee in Alamance County, and my co-chair is Josh Hayes. If you'll stand up. For CIT is Meredith Pepley with Cardinal Innovations. You'll stand up. So CIT is a 40-hour week intense training that first responders are trained how to handle situations in crisis, when people are in crisis. And we're linked with mental health resources to try to get people help rather than taking them to jail. First responders learn more effective interactions and remedies so that we don't have to go through the criminal justice system. A partnership between law enforcement and community resources improves the outcome for the individuals in crisis. CIT actually lays the groundwork for first responders, the mental health providers, advocates, and those persons with a mental illness, that we can have those conversations to lead to a much better outcome. And this training actually really does mean a lot for the whole community, because all the partners function as a team when we go through this training. CIT plays a significant role in advancing mental health promotion and public safety nationally and internationally. And the positive impacts it has on the community are: one, it decreases reportable injuries to the officer or to the individual that we're serving. It decreases the amount of time that an officer is having to spend. Number three, it decreases the amount of arrests that we're having to make. And number four, we're able to maintain active collaboration and partnerships with community stakeholders, okay? And so to end this, I just wanna say, Aristotle said, educating the mind without educating the heart is no education at all. Thank you.
Good afternoon, I'm Jeff Slanton with the Burlington Police Department. So I've been asked to speak about our co-responder program for just a moment, and that's not intuitive description. So what we call it maybe is a police crisis intervention specialist. So we've got on contract with RHA, and we appreciate the partnership with them. We pay for it, and they supply a certified counselor that's able to ride with a police officer, respond to the scene, help with any mental health issue, whether it's a committal or just counseling, or a person who's on medication that's supposed to be and maybe didn't take their medication this week, and we can just talk with them and get them back on their prescription medication. So we are, the largest municipality in Alamance County, have probably the highest concentration of mentally ill folks. And so my cops are the ones dealing with them regularly. We felt like we wanted to take an extra step in the stepping up process to divert and mitigate the harms created by arresting folks in crisis. So our co-responder program, we just got our big toe in the water. We've been at it for about a year. We're refining that process, and I look forward to some opportunities downrange to further expand on our successes, which we hope to have. It's already been great, but we're gonna keep going in that direction. We've asked for some grant support to grow that program, and then we're gonna share those resources with other folks in the county when we get there. So that's essentially what our co-responder program is. All right, thank you. And here's, I think, Kirk Bucket Kennedy is next.
Thank you, sir.
All right. Thank you.
We are pleased today to have Curtis Taylor as part of our program. Curtis has many accolades under his belt. We're gonna name just a few. He is the new Executive Director of the Alcohol and Drug Council of North Carolina, having previously served as its board chair. He has been appointed to a number of statewide advisory groups, including the Governor's Task Force on Mental Health and Substance Use, chair of the North Carolina Consumer and Families Advisory Committee, the Department of Health and Human Services Waiver Advisory Committee, and the North Carolina Stakeholders Engagement Group. But we are especially pleased to hear his perspective today as a person in recovery, someone who has lived the experience, and someone who has helped incarcerated citizens transition back into the community. Please join me in welcoming to Alamance County, Curtis Taylor.
Good afternoon. I had to make sure it was me that he was talking about there for a second. That sounds great. Who is that guy? My name is Curtis Taylor, and I am indeed a person in long-term recovery. And what that means for me is that I have not used alcohol or any other drug in over 15 years now. If you didn't clap for that, I was going to. I won't sugarcoat my past. Let me just say that I'm delighted to be in a room with law enforcement and sheriff's departments, and it's not my court date. This feels really good. I want to first thank the wonderful Miss Robin Huffman for inviting me and giving me another opportunity to be involved and support this movement. To me, this is absolutely incredible. As an African-American male, someone who spent time in what we call, for lack of a better term, active addiction, I have had to suffer through the challenges of being stereotyped. Well, law enforcement and government get stereotyped too. So I know if I was to roll back through the old hood and ask some of the fellas, you know, did they think somebody, a sheriff of 47 years, would have said some of the things he's had to say this morning, they would look at me like I was crazy. I cannot commend this group enough. To hear district attorneys, police officers, sheriff's departments, and government officials dedicate themselves to reducing the number of incarcerated citizens, that's incredible to me. That means the world to me. I have spent time incarcerated both in local county jail and the North Carolina Department of Corrections. I came home in 2004 with absolutely nothing. Not a dime in my pocket, not one change of clothes, no job, nothing to eat, nothing. God saw fit to place opportunity after opportunity after opportunity in my life. As a result of maintaining and sustaining long-term recovery, today I'm a homeowner. Today I'm a local business owner. I have a 5,500 square foot showroom in Raleigh, North Carolina, where I sell carpet and hardwood and laminate. RDC Floors, 919-247-7. You don't mind that, Robin. My estimates are free. I have this new fancy title as the executive director of the Alcohol Drug Council of North Carolina. Most people hear that and be like, well, what exactly does that mean? What do you do? So the Alcohol Drug Council of North Carolina was established in 1955. I am standing on the shoulders of some huge, huge predecessors, some legends in the state of North Carolina. Tony Mulvihill, Ann Doolin, Laddie Baker, and lastly, Mary Powell. And one of the main functions that my agency serves is a 1-800 information and referral hotline for any citizen in the state of North Carolina that is seeking help for treatment for substance use disorder. My trained call responders answer those phone calls every single day. They assess the situation and very quickly make that referral so that that person can get help. I also have a specialized perinatal person in my office who, once we get on the phone with a pregnant woman or a mother of young children, we do not get off the phone with that female until they're connected to a service. So I'm proud to wear that title. I can only hope that God continues to bless me in my role like he always does. If I can say anything about my own personal journey, it's that having been where I've been and having seen what I've seen, I have a very deep understanding that there is no person on this planet that's any better than or any less than any other individual on this planet. Each and every one of us makes mistakes every single day. The things that I was doing in active addiction, in my mind, they weren't choices. I wasn't making bad decisions. I was suffering from a disease. Substance use disorder and mental illness are just that, diseases. They're conditions. I'm not a moral failure. And I never was. Well, maybe on some level I was. I guess we all are at some point. But that wasn't the nuts and bolts. That wasn't the basis of what was happening with me. And so now, living this wonderful life of recovery, my life is dedicated to making sure that the next man and the next woman, the next mother, the next father, get to experience some of those same opportunities. Once given the title of convicted felon, in a lot of ways, it's like a death sentence in American society. So I'm proud to be on this stage, arm in arm, with the sheriffs and the police, trying to make things better, trying to make things different, so that once it's discovered that this person is suffering from a substance use disorder or a mental illness, we can focus our time and energy on trying to get that person the help they need, not locking them up in a cage like an animal. That's not going to help anybody. It's certainly not going to help that person. Lastly, of that long list of what the gentleman referred to as accolades, I take no credit, by the way, for anything good that comes from my life. I know who's working on my behalf. But one thing that he left off of that list, which is the most important to me, is the fact that today I'm a father. I've got a 6'4", 16-year-old son that just last night got his first dunk in a basketball game. And let me tell you, that boy can eat. And so today, my son has what you folks would refer to as protective factors in his life, because his father is in long-term recovery. I'm not an ex-offender to my son. Let me say that again. My name to my son is not ex-offender. That is not what he calls me. I'm dad. Today, I can stand and say that again, I'm a homeowner, a taxpayer, I'm a responsible and productive citizen of the state of North Carolina, doing everything in my power to give back and make my community better. If society did not give me the opportunities to find gainful employment, if society did not allow me to get financial aid so I could go back to school, I couldn't stand here and tell you today that I just finished another semester of 5 classes at Shaw University and I'm still maintaining that 4.0 GPA. When God opens a door, I'm going to run through it. You better believe it. When Robin Huffman invites me somewhere to get involved with something, I'm going to be right there. Believe that. But this right here, this is nearest and dearest to my heart. I understand that more than likely, unfortunately, there will always be a need for county jails and even the prison system in some shape or form. But this I know for sure. Our jails and our prisons right now, at this very moment, are filled with a whole lot of other Curtis Taylors. And any of those men and women, if we can just give them a chance, if we can just give them that opportunity, there's no reason in the world that they cannot flourish just as I am today in recovery. I'm honored to speak with you today. I appreciate your attention. Thank you for letting me share.
I think that's what you refer to as a story. First night to bring that.
Yes, sir.
Very much. It is also our privilege today to welcome Cody Kinsel, the interim senior director of the North Carolina Division of Mental Health, Developmental Disabilities, Substance Abuse Services, which is a division of the Department of Health and Human Services. A native of North Carolina, Mr. Kinsley has worked in both private and public sectors, focusing on healthcare management and health information technology. Before moving back to North Carolina this year, he worked for a number of years in Washington, D.C. in several capacities. Most recently, he served as the Assistant Secretary for Management for the United States Treasury, where he led a team responsible for developing the Treasury Department's budget and strategic planning. As taxpayers, we truly thank you for that. That was a joke. We're incredibly honored that the efforts of Alamance County's Stepping Up Initiative have merited the attention of the North Carolina Department of Health and Human Services, and we sincerely welcome Mr. Cody Kinsley to be a speaker on.
When people hear the Treasury piece, they immediately want to know if I was a revenue agent. I was more on the spending your money well side, so hopefully that gives me a little bit more credit. I also want to say that I'm 6'3", I eat a whole lot, and I'm not Curtis's son. And now you know the secret to getting me to come to any event is just having hot dogs. So thank you all so much. Also, I want to say that I think you invited me when I was the deputy, and that changed transition. We were trying to figure out who should be where and what staff. I said, no, Alamance County would dance with me when I was in the old job, so they get me now too. So happy to be here. This is a day of celebration and action. Celebrating the leadership of Alamance County has shown in the Stepping Up Initiative and even showcased at the national level. And action in continuing our efforts to forge partnerships in this community and address what's been called the criminalization of mental illness. Your passion and your energy is palpable today. And week two on the job as the interim director at the division, I can think of no better place to be. Because our core priority at the division is integrating the span of inpatient and community-based mental health services to wrap around our consumers. And expanding that partnership to all of our government and community partners, spending the right dollars the right way for the best possible outcome. It's more efficient and it's far more effective. And I know that much of what I say today will be preaching to the choir, reinforcing the beliefs that this community clearly holds so dearly. So I hope that you'll take this message of truth that you found, what you know, and call your colleagues in other counties, your friends, maybe even share it with those Russians on Facebook, and tell everyone in the state and beyond about the great work happening here in Alamance County. Because the basic truth is that most people with mental illness who end up in jail are not dangerous, but find themselves in jail for behaviors like trespassing, disturbing the peace, that are not significant threats to public safety. With a little help, with patience, and our compassion, these individuals are much better served in other arenas. And our communities and neighborhoods are better when people have access to the care they need. Alamance County is leading the way. It's truly inspiring to see how your community has come together so thoughtfully to help your most vulnerable citizens. Your early adoption and widespread implementation of CIT training, your successful efforts to obtain the Bureau of Justice Assistance Planning Grant, and implementing a range of jail diversion programs, hiring mental health professionals to work in the jail, your 24/7 diversion center, the list goes on and on. Most importantly, it's the committed leadership that I see from the county commissioners, Sheriff Johnson, Department of Social Services, Alamance Regional Hospital, the police, and others. Not only will your solutions benefit your citizens with mental illness, but they will enable you to make more efficient and effective use of your resources here in Alamance County. Keep your community safe and healthy, so that Alamance County can continue to be the best place to live in North Carolina. We're trying to step up on the state level also. We're trying to use our platform to make sure that we're showcasing the great work happening here and championing events like this. Many of our staff are scattered throughout the state today, speaking at similar events. We've held networking conference calls with our state stepping up counties so that you can learn from each other, you can support each other in your efforts and find your path that made sense for your community. We've held webinars to offer technical assistance and practical advice that could be implemented to evaluate your progress. And I think many know we're very excited about the recent grant funding that will help us implement a sequential intercept mapping training that I hope many of you will have the opportunity to participate in. It will help us determine opportunities for conversion systematically, identify the resources to be tapped, and then make it happen. The Stepping Up Initiative has achieved great success in North Carolina. 46 of our counties and growing have signed resolutions pledging their work to this effort. But we need everyone to step up. We need every county and every community partner that can play a role. Help us spread the word about the impact happening here in Alamance County. And as you know intimately, critical to diverting people to the right services is having the health insurance coverage that folks need to pay for those services. We must close the coverage gap, working with both private insurers and Medicaid to do so. Because without closing the coverage gap, we don't have a way to sustain these services in the community. And we can't provide the help that those individuals with mental illness need that end up in jails in the first place. Sheriff Johnson said that we have been failing individuals in this state with mental illness, and I could not agree more. Closing the coverage gap is critical to us changing that paradigm. In Alamance County, you have demonstrated what can be accomplished when a community joins together to address the problem. When your mental health system, your courts, your law enforcement, criminal justice partners, ice cream providers, social services, and others join for a common cause and a shared goal, there's nothing you cannot accomplish. The state, myself, we thank you, we applaud you. Thank you.
First of all, thank you for allowing me to be here this afternoon. Commissioner Byrd asked me to make sure we recognize the chairman, Andy Gailey, who's the board commissioner. I can't see because of the lights, but we want to stand up and get it. She's here.
She's obviously have to leave early.
What I'd like to do is just take a few moments and put a local impact on what we've been talking about today. How does this affect Alamance County? We know Alamance County Detention Center is the largest mental health holding facility in our area and our community. We in law enforcement, we know that jail only makes a person in crisis with mental illness, that situation worse. It's not ideal, it's not therapeutic. We also know that incarcerating those with mental illness puts a burden on our judicial system and our detention facility. There is a financial cost to our taxpayers, but make no mistake, there is an unbelievable human toll. So knowing this as we went in to this initiative, we wanted to take a look inside what's going on here in Alamance County and look at some numbers in our jail. So we selected one month. And in that month, we booked 476 new persons into our jail. 65 of those were identified with mental illness. 51 of those were receiving psychiatric medication. So that was about $4,000 just for medicine in that month for those 51. 10 were on isolated suicide watch, which is just about one-for-one supervision. It's a drain on the manpower, so there's a cost there. 9 were on detox monitoring. 42 of those 65 were booked for non-violent nuisance misdemeanors. Trespassing, they've just been a nuisance, somebody's in crisis, they've shot, they've done something non-violent, they're in crisis and they're acting out. Unfortunately, an officer arrives, they have limited options, jail, DD, or emergency department, or IBC, a lot of times that winds up being jail. 40 of those 42 were repeat offenders, back in our jail again. So if we just do some basic math, so there's 43 inmates, that's our daily average, with mental illness for the nonviolent nuisance misdemeanors, and we just take our jail budget divided by bed days. So I'm getting really basic. There's some bigger cost here, but that's about $77 a day, not including the meds. We run that out for a year. We spent $1.2 million housing nonviolent nuisance misdemeanors in our local jail. So we said, let's take a look again, and let's maybe look at a particular case. So we did a case study, and we'll call this case study inmate 22197. So in a period of 3.5 years, he was booked 26 times, all for nonviolent nuisance misdemeanors. He spent 711 days in pretrial custody. That's awaiting trial. Cannot make bond. He's waiting to go to court to have his day in court. Of those bookings, he spent 27.3 average days for each booking each time he was brought to jail. 23 of those 26 books, six bookings, he was released for time served. So when he got to court, the judge says, you've been in jail longer than you could have got, time served. While he was in custody, there were 39 incidents where either he was assaulted or he assaulted another inmate. The cost to house this one person to our taxpayers is $55,130. That's a human toll. And that's where we have the phrase here that we have people in our community that are serving the life sentence 30 days at a time. So what we want to do is do something about that. Thank you.
Well, good afternoon, everyone. My name is Brian Daygood. I'm Alamance County Manager for Alamance County Government. And it is just an honor to be able to be a part of 7th Day of Action today. I appreciate the opportunity to be here. And it is, let me say, it's been a real privilege just to be a part of this initiative. In my tenure as county manager, I've been county manager for a little over a year. And this was an effort that was well established before I joined it. And it's just been a real pleasure and one of the most rewarding programs that Alamance County Government has going on at this time. So I'm just thankful to be able to be a part of it today. And I wanted to speak to you for just a moment and give you some ideas of what's coming, what's in the future, our next step. The Stepping Up Group from Alamance County has long had a desire to create a facility in Alamance County that would serve as an alternative for folks that are currently being booked into the jail or being delivered to the emergency department at ARMC. So a building, a property that would become a place where law enforcement and EMS would have an alternative to take folks as opposed to jail or to the hospital. I had the good fortune of being able to travel with our local Stepping Up Initiative group to San Antonio, Texas, and got to see a facility, a diversion and restoration facility in San Antonio, and a program that's been built around that is the leader in the nation. Has just been it's extremely impressive. If you have an opportunity, if you're not familiar with that program, you should Google it and learn more about what Bexar County is up to along the city of San Antonio. While we were there, what we learned from the folks from San Antonio, Bexar County, helped reinforce just how effective and important a diversion and restoration center in Alamance County could be. It was quite impressive to see the strides that had taken place in Texas. Alamance County government has a model right now that's similar to what we're talking about with diversion and restoration. We currently operate the Family Justice Center. I know many of you are familiar with Family Justice Center. It's a model where Alamance County government serves as the backbone. The building is a county building. The county is there making sure lights stay on, building stays maintained, property stays managed, those kind of things. And then internally, you have nonprofits and other governmental groups providing services for folks that are seeking that have domestic violence issues. Well, the idea with the Diversion and Restoration Center is very similar. We were thinking the county would own the building and be that backbone for diversion also. So I'm happy to say that the group has worked together with our partners from RHA who currently provide our crisis service center, along with numerous folks from the community and our hospital to identify one of our county-owned buildings, the Elderly Services Building that's located over on Martin Street in Burlington. I'm sure many of you are familiar with it. Martin Street property already has a tradition as being a mental health service provided building, so it's already held in the, much of the community's minds as those are the services that are available there. The Elderly Services Building on Martin Street also is in proximity to many other nonprofit and governmental service providers, including DSS and HELP, and a whole host of nonprofit groups that are in that corridor. I know we recently had a meeting over at ARMC with all of those folks. It was impressive to see all the resources that are available in the Grand Lookdale Road corridor. So our thought would be the Elderly Services Building could become the new diversion and restoration center where RHA would offer crisis services for families, for people in need, as well as crisis services for people that law enforcement are transporting or our EMS group is transporting also. And what we could foresee is there would be wraparound services in this facility too. And so we have consulted with our folks at RHA. They've met with us, they've looked at the building, they feel like the building would be acceptable for use for this diversion and restoration center, and they're working with us now to help us think about what other groups might also join them in the diversion and restoration center. And so we reached the point where we all felt good about this plan, and we put together a business plan with Susan Osberg's help from DSS about how this would actually work, how it could be funded, how it would be sustainable. And we floated that business plan to our partners at Cardinal Innovations. And we have Mr. Rob Ryan here with us today from Cardinal Innovations. Very pleased to have him with us, Chief Development Officer for Cardinal. And Cardinal was so impressed with the amount of collaboration here in Alamance County, all the groups working together, and this model, this plan that we floated to them, that they agreed to fund the renovation of this property to the amount of $1.2 million that they would give Alamance County to help make this actually happen. We are just I can't say enough how pleased we are that Cardinal has partnered with us in this endeavor. I think this is the natural next step for diversion services and mental health services in Alamance County. I think the county is has a proven track record of being able to provide that backbone, that support, that blank canvas that the picture will be painted on. And we're just very glad to have Rob here with us today too. So Rob, if you'd like to join me here, so you can say something to the folks.
Yeah, thanks, Brian. This is really a privilege for me, frankly, to, is like you, I've had even less time and involvement in the project. I feel like just Ed McMahon getting to bring the check to the party. But for us, and let me just say again, Rob Bryan, Chief Development Officer at Cardinal. You know, for those of you that aren't familiar with Cardinal, we're the local LME MCO serving Alamance County. And through our providers, we serve members and their families with substance use disorders, mental health issues, and intellectual developmental disabilities. And this whole initiative is just a great fit for us and really excited. And I actually want to thank, there's a number of Cardinal folks here. Jennifer, Meredith, Lynn, you guys may just raise your hands, thank you. You guys are all well familiar with our new board member, Bob Bird, who I've had the privilege of getting to know over the past 4 or 5 months. Just a great advocate for you guys and for all the members we're talking about here. And for me and for Cardinal, on looking at this partnership and how we're getting to partner, I would actually say usually when you think about capital costs, that's not usually what you're jumping to fund, right? That's not the thing you're saying, hey, what's this cool thing we're doing? They did such a great job putting together their business plan for this and showing how this is sustainable. So we really get to just come in and say, hey, we're putting this money in, but the impacts of this, and frankly, I love the name too, because I said, you know, Diversion and Restoration Center. When I think diversion, I'm thinking there's some positives there, right? Like you're thinking, oh, you're not going to the emergency room, you're saving money. Or you're not going to jail, so we're saving money. We got those facts and figures. But when you think about the restoration, I thought about Kurt's, and I thought that's what it's really about. And the positive benefits, running a business, all the things, as he said, he's a good tax-paying citizen now. There's all these benefits that come from that. So for us, this is just a fantastic partnership, and we're, I'm excited to get to go through the building.
Well, if you didn't know anything about stepping up when you came in, or you knew a little bit about stepping up when you came in, you're now better educated. If you need some help, look on the back of your program, and you'll see a chapter of the book that is continuously being written, and it's being written every day. And stepping up is not just something we're doing today. Stepping up is something that's happening every day in Alamance County. At the Sheriff's Office, Sheriff Johnson is so committed to it that he was willing to give up a full-time position to create two part-time positions to make stepping up work and to make sure the momentum carried out every day. Those two part-time positions belong to the folks that keep us all from getting wide in the turns. Gary Andrew and Linda Allison. And in closing, I want to borrow a couple of lines from some of our speakers today. Mr. Haygood mentioned about San Antonio being a leader in diversion and restoration, and just truly a model that we went to see and many other municipalities went to see. Mr. Kinsley said, Alamance County is leading the way. And there's no doubt in my mind that as this book continues to be written, one day, very soon, people are going to be Googling Alamance County stepping up, and they'll come here to see what we are doing. Thank you all very much for being here.